Human beings clearly love drugs. They're everywhere, from alcohol to psychedelic toad venom. Every culture in human history has looked for ways to alter its consciousness. So why are some drugs legal and some drugs illegal? Why do our policies around drugs seem to make no sense at all? I'm JS Rafaeli. I've spent years writing about drugs, why people take them, and why our governments chose to declare war on them. Advice, we make a lot of films about drugs, but in this show, I get to dig a bit deeper. I get to talk to fellow expert drug nerds about their research into the crazy world of mind-altering substances. Michael Pollan is a writer who spent 30 years looking at humankind's relationship with plants, how we shaped their evolution, and how they shaped ours. Today, we're going to be talking about why some plants are legal, why some plants are illegal, and why we should think about our morning cup of coffee like we think about taking opium or mescaline. In his new book, This Is Your Mind on Plants, Pollan looks at three essential plant-based drugs, caffeine, mescaline, and opium, which have fundamentally shaped human history and society. Michael, it's a real pleasure to have you on the show. What's your interest in the relationship between plants and the human mind?
I wrote This Is Your Mind on Plants because I wanted to explore this really curious fact about our species, which is that all people everywhere have a universal desire to change consciousness. And most cultures, 99% of them, have found a plant that helps them do it. What is that about? What is it good for? Why do we have this desire? I've been writing about the relationship of plants and people since I started gardening. I wrote a book called Botany and Desire, which really looked at the symbiotic relationships between plants and people. When I recognized that not only do we change them through domestication and giving them new habitat and breeding, they change us too. I came to see that plants have a lot of agency. They have their own agenda. Sometimes it coincides with us, sometimes it doesn't. And that's what started me on this journey, looking at opium, mescaline, and caffeine.
So where caffeine is a sort of drug that has transformed all of global society, mescaline seems much more specific to one particular culture. And I'd like to talk a little bit about the Native American peyote religion and how that developed and the role that it plays within that society.
So there are these two classes of cactus that produce mescaline that we know of. One is peyote, the other is San Pedro. What kind of cactuses are those behind
you? Oh, interesting ones.
Looks like baby San Pedros. It's a very interesting substance. Mescaline is a psychedelic. It's an alkaloid. It comes from some cactus, two kinds of cactus. San Pedro, which grows in South America, and peyote, which grows in a region around the Rio Grande River on both sides in Mexico and southern Texas. And it, in some ways, is like other psychedelics, but in others, it's really distinct. There's not a lot of hallucination. It's very much a here and now drug. It immerses you in your place, your moment, more deeply than you ever have before. At least that was my impression. And you can spend an hour looking at a bowl of apricots or a flower in a vase or out a window and see more than you've ever seen. It is as if the doors of perception have been cleansed or open wide. Reality is richer than we know. And you get an inkling of that on mescaline. You see nuances of color you've never noticed before. I mean, just a kind of, the texture of the world is just ultimately richer and more fascinating than you thought. It's indigenous people that were using psychedelics thousands of years ago. Peyote was used at least 6,000 years ago. And we are learning something they already knew. These are the native people, especially the New World, which was that these changes of consciousness could put you in touch with the divine, but they were also powerful healing tools. And so I wanted to look at the indigenous use of a psychedelic, and specifically the Native American church. In North America, Native Americans have the legal right to use peyote, and they use it in a ceremony that has proven to be incredibly helpful in healing their traumas. And this is a very traumatized people. I don't know if people realize just how bad it got in America in the late 19th century for Native Americans. It was official U.S. government policy to destroy their culture. Their ceremonies were banned. They were children were removed from their parents. They had their hair cut, and their hair is like symbolically very, very important. It was at this moment that they discovered or really rediscovered the power, the healing power of peyote. So I think we have a lot to learn from them. I'm not saying we need to imitate their ceremonies. I don't think it's appropriate to our culture, but there's some underlying principles that are really important. I mean, for example, they never use a drug, a psychedelic casually. It's always with intention. There's some purpose. They do it only on special occasions. There's always an elder involved, you know, someone who knows the territory. And it's always surrounded by ritual. And I think that's really important. I think people who use drugs in a ritual way, rather than casually or wantonly, are not the people who get in trouble with drugs.
I think one of the most interesting words that you just used there is sort of elder, right? Because we are presented so often, we're kind of sold a vision of drugs, where it's sort of something that like young people go off and do, and old people go kind of like, no, 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 you shouldn't do that. Whereas in the Native American ritual, it's actually something that sort of brings generations together and is like a force for cohesion in society rather than tearing it apart.
I was very interested in that because when psychedelics came to the West, you know, they arrived in the 50s and 60s in Europe, in the United States, and they were these powerful substances, and they didn't, there was no instruction manual. Nobody said, you know, this is how you use them. So we just tried a lot of different things, some of which were crazy. We put LSD in the punch bowl. The CIA dosed people without their permission just to see what would happen. People took psychedelics under like really suboptimal conditions. And there were people who crashed and burned as a result. We use them very often recklessly. But here were Native Americans for whom it was a very conservative force. It was a way to weave young people into society. You would have rites of passage that involved peyote. It was a very socially cohesive ceremony. It tells us there may be another way to construct psychedelics in our society. And I think we're moving there. This whole move towards psychedelic therapy. The identity of psychedelics is shifting from being a disruptive force to being a tool that may help our society deal with a mental health crisis. There is a movement in America now called Decriminalized Nature, which seeks to legalize all plant medicines. They don't include opium among the plant medicines. And that's because opium, it would have been hard to pass because opium is regarded as so evil right now. That, you know, that points to the fact that drugs are complicated. They're, you know, the same drug can be a blessing or a curse, depending on the context in which it's used. And opium currently is a curse. But we need to remember that even it is a blessing to many people. If you've ever had surgery or even serious dental work, and for people near death, it's a blessing.
And in the new book, let's take caffeine. The big headline here is that we're all basically drug addicts, right?
90% of us have a daily relationship with caffeine. And most of those people are, I would say, dependent on it. And if you want to check and see whether that is you, skip it for a day and see how you feel.
The thought fills me with horror. you actually did that, though, to write this section of the book. You went cold turkey. How was that for you?
Oh, it sucked. It was terrible. So I went 3 months without caffeine. I went cold turkey. Initially, I felt like I had acquired attention deficit disorder. I mean, I just could not focus on anything. I was very easily, anything could distract me in the field of my attention. I also felt like a veil had dropped between me and reality, that it was just not so transparent. There was a fog. And that persisted for at least a week. After a week or so, I began to be able to focus enough to get a little bit of writing done. I don't think it was very good. But for the entire 3 months, I felt as if I wasn't myself. And that's quite remarkable to realize that myself depends on this plant and that what I thought of as my normal, ordinary consciousness was in fact caffeinated consciousness. Speaking of which, I'm getting my
got visited by a drug dealer.
I did. My wife. Yeah. She prepared the coffee.
So what are the particular effects on consciousness that caffeine is imposing on us? What are we looking for from it?
Well, caffeine does a lot for us. It does make us more alert. it gets in the way of the chemical that increases our sleep pressure. Over the course of the day, there's this chemical, it's called a neuromodulator, called adenosine, and it builds up, levels build up in your brain till eventually you're tired and you go to sleep. Caffeine fits into the exact same receptor and gets in the way. So the adenosine never gets to hook into the receptor, therefore you never feel it. It's still circulating in your brain, but it's not registering. And you get this kind of rebound tiredness. And what will you do then? You'll probably have another cup of coffee. Coffee proposes itself as the solution to the problem that coffee creates. It's kind of a brilliant molecule, caffeine. But there are other things going on that can't be explained simply through this adenosine receptor. And that is the fact that it also helps our focus. Psychologists talk of two kinds of focus. There's spotlight consciousness, which allows us to block everything out, focus on our work, get a lot of stuff done. And it's really valuable to our species and to civilization. And then there is something else called lantern consciousness, where you're not focused so much, but you're taking in information from all over, from all your senses. Caffeine increases spotlight consciousness, and that's why it's such a good work drug. Even bees who receive caffeine from certain plants that they pollinate, specifically citrus, the citrus family, they will remember where they got that caffeine and return to it very predictably. And it's one of the ways those flowers manipulate the bees. Give them a little shot of caffeine and they remember and they come back and they're more what they call faithful pollinators.
Picking up on the work and manipulation theme, in terms of society, coffee is introduced to Europe at sort of precisely the moment that capitalism is invented, almost the same sort of set of decades. And these two events are perhaps not coincidental.
No, I don't think they are at all. I think caffeine really sped capitalism, helped capitalism rise. It's not the only thing that was happening, obviously, but I think it was critical. Unlike other drugs, most other big drugs like alcohol or the opiates or cannabis, which have been around for thousands of years, and we don't really have a record of what the world was like before they came in. Since caffeine comes in so late, we have a real sense of before and after. And so caffeine comes along and is clearly implicated in the rise of this age of reason and scientific revolutions of the 17th, 18th centuries, the Enlightenment, and the rise of capitalism. The best proof I know for the idea that caffeine is a great tool for capitalism is the institution of the coffee break. I guess you have a tea break in England, but in America, twice a day, your employer gives you a free drug and then gives you paid time in which to ingest it, the coffee break, 20 minutes at 10 o'clock, 20 minutes at 4 p.m. Why would they do that? Why would your employer do that? They do that because it makes you a better worker. Just when you're flagging in the day, you get this boost and efficiency goes up and quality of work goes up. And so it's definitely served capitalism. And it's hard to imagine it without caffeine.
Okay, and so that sort of brings us on to the third plant that you talk about, which is opium or the opium poppy, which also occupies this like weird space of being sometimes legal and sometimes not legal. And I know you kind of have some like personal experience of that as well.
So Papaver somniferum, which is the plant that produces opium, also produces one of the most gorgeous flowers. They're all over English gardens and they're all over a lot of American gardens. They're spectacular flowers. What people don't realize very often is that you can turn the seed head that comes out after the flower drops its blossoms into opium. In fact, all you have to do is slit that seed head and a white sap will emerge, and that is opium. Now, you need quite a bit of it and you have to collect it, and it's a somewhat difficult process. But there it is. It's a fairly mild narcotic you can make from it. You can also make a tea. And we've been told for many years that, oh, you can only grow opium in Turkey or Afghanistan. No, you can grow it in your backyard. And the government doesn't want us to know that. So they have cracked down at various times on people disseminating information about poppies. So I grew poppies. This is in the late 90s, at a time when the drug war was raging in America. And I found a book called Opium for the Masses, written by a man named Jim Hogshire, who was a zine writer, kind of an underground drug journalist. He would be writing for Vice in another time, or I was writing for the Times and Harper's, and I'm gonna see if I can make my own opium. And so I got the seeds, and I started corresponding with him and interviewing him. And then suddenly I get word that he's been arrested on drug charges for manufacturing a narcotic. And the evidence is a box of dried poppy heads that he bought at a florist shop in Seattle. And the weird wrinkle in the law that you were alluding to earlier is that growing poppies is fine unless you know it's opium, in which case it's a crime, a federal crime. If you have the knowledge in your head and they can prove it, you're guilty. But the other thing I had learned since, we all learned, is that that same summer that I was having my fear and paranoia over my poppy crop and the government was going after people like me, Purdue Pharma, the pharmaceutical company, was introducing OxyContin and beginning the opioid crisis, marketing it aggressively to doctors and consumers as a safer, less addictive opiate. And starting what, you know, ended up being the biggest public health crisis tied to drugs during the whole period of the drug war.
And actually, at the same time as Purdue is marketing Oxy, there within the war on drugs, there's a really concerted effort to limit and decrease opioid substitution therapy and treatment in favor of a kind of like just say no, kind of like abstinence model, which is like way less effective. And I think like that, between that and the poppies and Purdue, it sort of just like illustrates how mixed up our relationship with this drug and like this plant really is.
The whole idea of harm reduction was not accepted at all. I mean, there were a few people talking about it. This idea that what kills people on opiates is not the opiate. It's the overdose, the fentanyl that it's laced with, or the fact that they're using contaminated needles. So many of the harms are related to the fact it's illegal. If it were legal and you knew exactly what dose you were getting, people can go on for a very long time, you know, dependent on opiates. It doesn't necessarily kill you or ruin your life. But when it's illegal, people are forced onto the black market.
So from a drug world point of view, one of like the big macro trends that we're seeing now is that for like thousands of years, all our drugs have been based on plants, like alcohol, tobacco, heroin, cocaine. But what we're seeing now is the rise of like purely synthetic drugs, which are only made in a lab. As a sort of plant writer, what do you feel about that?
I think we can over-romanticize nature, and the idea that they're automatically better because they're plant drugs isn't always true. You know, LSD came out of a lab, even though it's derived from a fungus, the ergot fungus, and many people find that it's a really valuable substance. And there are lots of drugs that, you know, there's a vaccine keeping a lot of us alive right now that came out of a laboratory, didn't come out of a plant. I think we learn from plants. I think they're the ultimate model. So I think it depends. I don't think we can generalize and say plant drugs are better than synthetic drugs.
So if there was one major idea or thought that you wanted people to take from this book and this thread of research that you've engaged in, what would that be?
Well, I think to understand the ambiguities of drugs, you know, I've been saying lots of very positive things about them, but people do get into trouble, and addiction is a real problem, and it's not always the drug's fault. It's sometimes the fault of society and the straitened circumstances of people's lives. But you know, the Greeks really had it right. Their word for drug was pharmakon, a word that means both ally and poison, and it has a third meaning too. Scapegoat. And certainly scapegoats, we scapegoat drugs. We blame a lot of our problems on drugs because it's easier than looking ourselves in the mirror or looking our society in the mirror. So we should remember that the drug is one thing, but it's how we use it, the respect that we bring to the experience, the sense of intention, and that we need to just kind of hold two conflicting ideas in our head. That the same substance can be an enormous boon to your life, or it can be hell.